this talk, I will present a method for defining site sizes by means of features excavated along a street construction, a project which developed out of my master's thesis in prehistoric archaeology, which was realized at the Free University of Berlin with data by the Heritage Management in Saxony-Anhalt. Linear excavation projects, as for street or pipeline construction, offer a glimpse into the archaeological record. Better? Yeah, better? Good. Okay. Linear excavation projects have been praised to turn up many new sites that were not identifiable by surface collection and thus are an important corrective to preconceived notions about settlement developments, especially in rural areas. My take on the transect analysis was inspired by the idea that a long excavation may yield more information if seen as a continuous trench, in contrast to understanding it as a line of distinct sites. In essence, this is similar to the non- or off-site archaeology that was developed by Foley and Thomas and others in the 70s and 80s. In the following minutes, I will begin with an introduction to my dataset as to facilitate the explanation of theoretical and methodological aspects. I present my analysis and results, and hopefully in a way that encourages critical review and draw a conclusion based on discussion of the results. In the 2000s, in Saxony-Anhalt, Middle Germany, a street was built called Bundesstraße 16. As is the law in that state, the area of the street, approach roads, exits, and retention reservoirs were machine test trenched by the Heritage Management to find archaeological sites. Along the about 13 kilometers long and 40 meter broad part of the street I analyzed, 52 different sites were delimited by the Heritage Management, of which 24 contained features dating to the periods which I focused on. The time frame I look at begins around 4000 BC, which is the Middle Neolithic, and ends with the early Iron Age, about 50 BC. There are 4,770 features catalogued as belonging to these periods or as undated, and you can see the specific number of settlement features belonging to the periods in this table. It is easy to see that only with the beginning of the late Neolithic, which is the corded ware culture, enough features for statistical analysis were excavated. Because of the test trenching, I assume that all features and sites along the transect have been found, even though there are gaps between the actual excavation areas. Machine trenching has been shown to be the most effective way to find sites. Admittedly, even then, not all sites are discovered. Especially Neolithic ones have the least probability to turn up, which may be one of the reasons for the small number of Middle Neolithic features in the transect. As the street avoids settlements, it is mostly crosses agricultural land, and only few sites were known before the excavation. It was not built with an archaeological research question in mind, so I dare to say it is a random sample of the archaeological record. Nonetheless, we must note that the number of undated features is high in relation to the dated features. 66% of the features could not be dated precisely. Therefore, I am working with a subsample of about 34% of the features inside the transect, and this subsample most probably is not random, as the identification probabilities of different periods may vary. As you can see, there are a number of features dated to late Bronze Age and early Iron Age, and that's actually a known problem in Middle Germany, that the ceramics in this time period, the settlement ceramics, are very similar, so researchers agree that it's actually a continuation in this time between the late Bronze Age and the early Iron Age, and only burial practices changed. I deal with this uncertainty of dated features by adding these features to the late Bronze Age analysis as well as to the early Iron Age analysis. Some theoretical issues. The term site has been at the center of a lively debate in survey archaeology over the last 40 years. Until the 70s, it has mostly been defined as a place, like a find spot, which is quite similar to German archaeology, where the term used, Fundplatz, means exactly that. In archaeological inventories, though, a site may contain several cultural distinct loci, which are usually catalogued as a settlement, a burial ground, a hoard, or as a single find spot of a period. In the American processual discourse, a site has been, for example, a spatial relationship between archaeological finds, and post-processually it has been argued that this is nothing but a modern analytical category without any archaeological meaning by itself. Since the middle of the 1970s, there has been the discussion of a non- or off-site archaeology, and this term describes the analysis of finds in between sites. The archaeological record was now understood as a continual distribution in space, with spots of higher densities, sites, and areas of lower densities which are worthwhile to research as well. With this view on the archaeological record, the discussion about the identification of the spatial boundaries of a site arose anew. In German archaeology, the discussion was not so much focused on the sites in general, but more specifically on the detection of settlements. Next to the problem of qualitatively deciding what kinds of finds and features do I need to call this a settlement, one problem of site detection by survey that has been discussed is the question of how far apart two sites are supposed to be. So if I find two shirts at a distance of 50 meters apart, are these two sites or do they belong together? In every larger settlement or landscape archaeological study, this topic is being discussed, and in the end, a decision felt, which the authors agree, is kind of arbitrary and should actually rely on empiric studies. So me, thinking about my transect, thought I might be able to work out an approach to look for distances between settlements and typical settlement sites. I'm ignoring the sites delimited by the heritage management and take the transect as a continual distribution of archaeological features, as in the off-site approach. I draw upon the thoughts of Plock et al. To define boundaries. They say sites are a discrete and potential interpreted locus of cultural materials. By discrete, we mean spatially bounded, with those boundaries marked by at least relative changes in artifact densities. And the quote goes on, but as I am focusing on settlement sizes here, I only use those features that do not belong to a burial or hoard context. As I am not including find distributions, places like working areas or fields which may be detected by off-site archaeology won't be included. Nonetheless, features between settlements may exist, such as wells, temporary storage facilities, or similar. So the relative changes in artifact densities are, in my case, transferred to relative changes in feature densities. As a proxy for density, I use the distance between features. This measure is quite well known from cluster analysis, and this is something which I actually want to detect, clusters of features that might be interpretable as settlement sites. Formal cluster detection analyses such as Ripley's K, the FOG function, would rely heavily on edge correction to compensate for the slimness of my transect. I tested them, and depending on the different correction algorithms, receive quite different curves. Instead, I'm not correcting at all for edge because, admittedly, a transect is all edge, as Alice Trigger once put it. Fully knowing that I only have a very narrow glimpse into the archaeological record, I rely on the length of my transect to give my results credence. My methods. I worked with the SPATS package of R, which offers the possibility to create point pattern datasets within a window which can take complex forms. This was needed as the trench boundaries were multiple polygons. After subsetting my points for different periods, I calculated the distances to each other in these periods. These distance vectors are the basis for all further calculations. You will note I always crop them at a distance of 1,000 meters. Otherwise, the scale of the analysis becomes too large for site detection. For comparison of the dated features with a random distribution, I created a complete spatial random and independent and identically distributed point distribution within the excavated areas. Two different approaches are used to find settlement sizes, a cumulative one to get outside boundaries, and a density approach which will show minimal settlement sizes or clusters inside the settlement. The exact code I use is online on GitHub, which is very, very ugly, so please don't look at it, but you can see the details of my analysis if you want to. Okay, cumulative analysis. First, I cumulatively sum how often features have a certain distance to each other. This means on the y-axis you can have the proportion of features that have a distance of x or smaller to one another. The turning point at which the curve flattens, meaning the increase drops, meaning the distances grow larger, can, in my opinion, be interpreted as settlement boundaries. Already in this very simple analysis, different settlement patterns arise, and you can see that the CSR distribution is less clustered than all others. The density analysis, on the other hand, tries to find typical cluster size or minimal sizes of a settlement. And for this, I use a kernel density estimation on top of the distance measures to find the most common distances, the peaks in the KDE, or the least common distances, which are the minima. The most common distances may be understood as a radius because we do not know in which direction the features lie. Minima may be interpretable as distances between settlements, as these are the gaps between the features. It is notable that the random distribution has also a peak in the beginning. This is the result of the slimness of the transects and the sizes of the excavation areas. Nonetheless, all the cultures show that they are more densely clustered than a random distribution by showing higher peaks. Also, they all have a distinct minimum, contrary to the random point pattern. Following, I will present the results and a very condensed interpretation. I took the calculated values and research published large excavation in Middle Germany to see whether there are any settlements that have comparable sizes. The 32 features of the corded ware culture are loosely scattered in clusters of about 120 meters in my transect. At 300 meters, the distance to the next features rises rapidly, and as a distance between settlements, I propose about 530 meters. There is only one site in Middle Germany which I could find, in Thuringia, called Luckau Forst, which revealed housesteads of the corded ware. They are distributed in a triangle with a site length of about 125 meters, which fits quite well with my results, though the houses there are much closer to each other than features in my transect. Yeah, I could not find any larger sites to compare with the other numbers I calculated. The early Bronze Age, or Unitice culture, has only 25 features in this analysis, which are all found in the western part of the transect. There are five houses, and it is notable that the distances the houses have to each other dominate the distribution. The turning point of the cumulative analysis, about 220 meters, correlates quite well with the sizes of known Unitice ring ditches in Thuringia and Saxony. Ditches are often interpreted as settlement boundaries. And the distance between settlements, which I propose here, has an almost exact equivalent at the excavation of the very same street, B6N, just a few hundred, not quite hundred, a few tenths of kilometers further west between Benzingrode and Heimburg, where also two Bronze Age settlements were cut and they're exactly 430 meters apart from each other, almost the very same number I calculated. We need to keep in mind, though, that these two data sets are quite small, and especially in the cumulative analysis, you can see the influence of every feature on the curve. For later periods, much more features could be excavated. And as you can see, the late Bronze Age features cluster most densely. The minimal settlement size of about 65 meters in diameter is comparable to individual late Bronze Age or early Iron Age farmsteads that have been recorded at Zwenkau in Saxony. The cumulative distribution has an insidious slow change of slope, which makes it difficult to determine a turning point. I think this is a sign of not being able to differentiate between different settlements well. This might be due to alternating settlements, meaning people rotated their settlement places faster than we can track archaeologically, and several settling events overlap each other. For the settlement in Zwenkau, this has actually been assumed. There, the single farmsteads, though, lie more closely together than what I calculated as a minimum density in the kernel density estimation. For the late Bronze Age and early Iron Age, it's a bit difficult because, as I said before, it's difficult to separate these two periods. In this context, it actually seems interesting to me that the early Iron Age features do have an influence on their distribution. We have a more widely spread distribution, and the minimum of the kernel density estimation is by far the smallest value of the four calculated. There are two possible explanations. Either a number of the late Bronze Age features actually belong to the early Iron Age, and thus the distances recorded here are larger than they actually should be, or it is a sign that the settlements grow in the early Iron Age and move closer to each other. But because of the mentioned dating problems, I'd rather be careful not to overinterpret these results. And the farmsteads in Zwenkau, which were dated to late Bronze Age and early Iron Age together, don't compare well in size with these values, though better in regards to distances between them. So to conclude, different settlement strategies can be recorded, and except for dating problems, the suggested site sizes are comparable to known large-scale excavations. To discuss this method, I summarize positive and negatives of this approach. Positively, My transact data is, in my opinion, a more precise data set to define site sizes than what a survey may offer, because it is independent of visibility issues and less dependent on geomorphology. A direct comparison of the two approaches might actually be helpful to understand the connection better. This method is an approach to help with the quantification problem that the German settlement archaeology has discussed. It also showcases that a site is not always the same as a settlement, which I think is still quite often conflated. It can easily be adapted to other kinds of features, for example, graves or features dating to consecutive periods to detect small-scale settlement shifts. But of course, there are some difficulties remaining. Especially the dating of the features remains a problem. For statistical analysis, enough features need to be dated as finely as possible as to minimize the time depth in each time slice analyzed. We need to be aware of seasonally changing settlements within one period. And also, the finer dating of those undated features, which are most in my transect, might change the results of this analysis completely. Of course, the boundary of a settlement, as defined by prehistoric people, may well lie outside the built space, which I can analyze using features. Also, the length of the transect and the number of features that I could analyze might not be enough for reliable calculations, and therefore I suggest to test this on different and larger data sets. Thank you for your attention. I'd be happy to continue the discussion and hear your thoughts and opinions.